So we are back. I've been on factual errors, and I promised I will give you the reasons as to why students commit those errors. One, fidgeting. They fear exams. They fear exams. It's as if they are going to be guillotined. Eh? They fear exams. Why must you fear? You shouldn't fear. Because you decided to learn, and so you should be evaluated. So don't fear. Don't fear. During the time of the World Economic Depression, the American president, Roosevelt, with his Glass-Steagall Act, told the Americans that the greatest fear we Americans must fear is fear itself. When you fear, you lose. So don't fear. Two, panic. Students panic so much. They panic. And these are candidates you find reading in the last minute. So they become panicky. And in the long run, they commit factual errors. When you fear and then you panic, there are certain things which come in. Anxiety, emotionalism. You find students even beginning to develop sicknesses which are not even common in their clan. They are not common in their clan. They are taken for testing, but the sicknesses are not there. Why? Because they are panicking and they are under fear. Such as things cause factual errors. Next, which is H, is the level of organization. We have the level of organization. How organized is the candidate? As reflected in this, I will tell that this candidate was not organized. How do I tell? The art of paragraphing. The art of paragraphing. How does the candidate paragraph his paragraphs, his essays? Are the paragraphs well done in the essay? Is there indenting? There is what you call indenting, jumping that small space as you are beginning your paragraph. Two, the size of the paragraphs. Students write paragraphs which are more bigger than the whole mountain. The whole paragraph is taking 2 pages. I mean, it is boring to the evaluator, to the examiner. Paragraph, size of paragraphs. And even the size of the paragraph, it must not be too small, because if it is too small, it means you are ordinary. So you must consider the aspect of a sizable paragraph. Two, jumping lines. We have what you call jumping of lines. This one is prohibited completely, especially in Uganda, at A-level evaluation process. Don't jump lines. You jump lines, you lose 4 marks automatically. So don't jump lines. You find students who are writing headings and subheadings. Headings and subheadings. Especially in questions of causes and effects. Explain the causes and effects of the World Economic Depression. No. And you find a student after the introduction say causes, then he underlines. Then from there you go to effects, then he underlines. No. The essay must flow in totality. If you are jumping from the causes, you say it should be noted that the World Economic Depression had a variety of effects, which were positive as well as negative, which were social, economic, and political, as analyzed below. But don't write headings and subheadings. They distort impression. Then there is the danger of familiarization. Familiarization. You are writing a message. It is as if you are writing a message to your girlfriend or boyfriend. In my conclusion, therefore, you are concluding as who? You are not even an iota of a historian at A level. You are not. Because your historical status is not yet gauged and judged and confirmed. So how do you conclude here? So you say in conclusion, therefore, you don't say in my conclusion, in my own sense, in my own understanding. You as who? Even great historians cannot conclude like that, like Thomson, like Mahajan. They can't conclude like that, including even the great family cannot conclude like that. So who are you to conclude in that man? So avoid familiarization. Next, avoid shorthand. Shorthand in the essays. Shorthand in the essays. Students are writing, cause. Did you see cause? Cause. This is because. Cause. They have written, cause. This is because. In the essay. In the essay. Avoid shorthand. Words should be complete. In totality, hey? Even these things of etc, you don't say etc, you say and others. Don't say etc, you say and others. So the moment you put there these things, they distort impression. So avoid them. Then avoid. I know the Americans will be annoyed with me. Avoid American English. We are marking using the English of the Queen of England. So avoid American English. Avoid American English. Because I know most of these students, because of .com, you are using the American English and you transfer that English to the essays, you will get problems. So use the original British English. Thank you very much. Then, now we move to another important thing which you must avoid. Another important thing which you must avoid in your presentation, rather in your choice of questions. So we go to choice of questions. Students, let me tell you, students fail not because they don't have knowledge, but many times they are betrayed. They are betrayed by the questions they choose. The questions they choose. Choice is very, very, very important in the life of an individual. The career you choose. The profession you choose. Even the partner you choose. It also applies to the questions you choose. What does it mean? We give you 10 questions and we say choose 4. It doesn't mean that we are supposed to do all. It doesn't mean that we are supposed to do all. Which means, in those questions, there are those ones which are doable, friendly questions, and there are those ones which are bad, and there are those ones which are dangerous. So when you are choosing these questions, you must be extraordinarily careful. And therefore, that's why I come up with the types of questions. Types of questions. Personally, as in Pamiri, I have 7 categories. I'm saying personally, as in Pamiri, I have 7 categories of questions. 7 categories of questions. In their own arrangement. And I will be showing you the advantages and disadvantages of every category. So it's up to you in the future which category you choose that will make you achieve what you want in your educational path. We have category number 1. That is what we call indirect questions. Indirect questions. These are, in most cases, they are philosophical questions. Their answers and interpretations are not direct. They are not. They are philosophical. I always say they are ideological questions. If there are these students who are bright enough, they can interpret them. But these students who are slow learners, who are a little bit weak, like those ones in rural areas who have never been guided, they may find these questions a little bit difficult. Like, for example, questions that deal with how successful, How successful? Just state it like this. How successful? Or a question like, how did he, with reference to impact? These are ideological questions. A question says, how successful was Adolf Hitler in Germany between 1933 to 1945? How successful? In real sense, you may think that the question is only demanding for successes only. No, the question is ideological. The question is hidden. In actual sense, the question is demanding for successes and failures. But the question is saying, how successful? Indirect question. How did the reign of Napoleon affect Europe? How did the 1815 Vienna settlement affect Europe? The question is two-sided. It affected Europe positively and negatively. So there are two-sided questions. And therefore they require a standpoint. And for that matter, the question is in the indirect. Two, we have what you call direct questions. Direct questions. Those are the best questions because they are common. Direct. Why? Explain causes and effects. What were the challenges? And how did Napoleon consolidate himself in power? Examine the obstacles to German unification. What were the aims and objectives of the Antarctic Charter? Of 1941, direct questions. Direct questions do not require a standpoint. Direct questions, they require exhaustive presentation of ideas. Why? Because direct questions, I can tell you, are very competitive. And that's where you find that almost every Tom, Dick, and Harry, even those students who don't know, they will attempt to those numbers. Direct questions, you will find the marking guide of a particular question is enormous. All ideas are there. So if you are to exhaust it, you must present a lot. But otherwise, they would be the best questions for you to answer. Direct worthy questions. Three, we have what we call controversial questions. Many times we call them evaluation questions. Controversial questions. Why are they controversial? They are controversial because they are not static. They are not static. They give you an idea and they want you to elaborate on a particular idea and then you consider other aspects. Those are the typically two-sided questions. Involving what? Involving questions like to what extent, how much, how far, quote, discuss, assess, evaluate. Others, when you go to institutions of higher learning, they say elucidate. Such a word, they say elucidate. Questions of that nature, which require standpoints, two-sided. So we call them controversial questions because you give an idea and then you counter-argue against that idea. Controversial questions. They are also good. And I may recommend you to answer those numbers. Why? Because they help you in building content. They help in building content. Building content. Like, rather than if you are doing a single-sided question, like, how did the continental system contribute to the downfall of Napoleon? A question like that one. You will discover that it has limited content. But if I say, how far did the continental system contribute to the downfall of Napoleon? You will find that you have enough content required for you to satisfy the impression of the examiner. We continue from there.